few speakers today. Jennifer St. Peter from Be the Match Foundation, and Mike Gama that's here to share his story. So I'm going to turn it over to them.
So I'm going to be brief, and then I'll come up at the end too. But Mike is really the most interesting person speaking. So I work for the Be the Match Registry, based out of the Rhode Island Blood Center. We cover all of New England. So I've been working with Kelly for a number of years now, and he drives here at the BCC campus to give information to students about what a marrow transplant is, who needs them, and kind of dispel those myths that are out there about marrow donations. And there's a lot of crazy stuff on TV that is not true about what happens if you are a bone marrow donor. I suspect Mike might touch on some of those when he's talking to you, but if not, I'm going to come up at the end and kind of give the hows you go about doing a marrow donation. Mike is the why, so he's the really important part for you guys to hear. So I'm going to turn it over to him. Mike is awesome. We've been working with you for a couple of years now, right?
Almost four years.
So we met Mike almost four years ago when he was diagnosed and needed to find a marrow transplant. And he has been so awesome sharing his story throughout his journey about the blood products that he's needed, about his marrow transplant experience. But I'm
going to
let him tell you that part of it. So, Mike.
Thanks. Hi, guys. Oh, no, don't clap yet. I might stink. So I really don't know my audience necessarily, but are you guys all blood donors? Do you guys all give blood, pretty much? And are those who are, you all look under 42, but do you guys, or four, but do you guys, are you guys all on the Marrow Registry also? Have you ever heard of it? Okay, I'm going to touch on both. The blood thing is kind of funny, right? Because I take it that you guys are going to be advocates for the blood center and their blood drive is coming up.
So we did the Marrow
today.
But we do one every semester on campus.
So both blood and marrow?
Just marrow.
Okay, then we'll deal with the marrow aspect. When you're talking with people, they always talk about the bone marrow transplant as opposed to the stem cell. It sounds horrific. And you can kind of understand people's concerns with getting on the registry. But I'll tell you, in 2010, I got involved with the Blood Center as a police officer in Rhode Island. And at the time, I had a phobia of needles. Anybody have one of those? They're like legit, right? Do you pass out? So for me, I just run. I panic. It's not, I don't pass out. I don't get queasy. I just freaking panic. But there was someone from the blood center. Her name was Jen also, who got a hold of me in my office. And she was young and energetic, like the rest of the blood center employees. And after like 20 minutes, she had convinced me to become this advocate, kind of like what you guys are, to do these donations for the marrow and for donating blood. So I kind of hung up the phone, and then it occurred to me that I had never donated blood. There's no way, man. So it occurred to me that now that I was going to have to be an advocate, and how do you back out? You can't. So I was going to have to get on that bus. You know, you've seen a big, huge blood center bus, right? So I kind of put it out of my mind, and then my office was in the front of the building. So, of course, I could hear the brakes coming from the bus like a mile away, and I remember panicking. I was like, oh, crap. So the bus pulls up, and I was trying to figure out how am I ever going to get on this bus. And I thought, well, Superman wears this... the uniform, you know, the Superman uniform. And, like, he's brave, right? Because other than that, he's a reporter and whatever. So I kept my uniform on, you know, I kept my gun on. I thought I was, like, kind of badass. So I get on the bus, and I was kind of talking fast, kind of like the way I am right now, when I'm nervous. So I was talking. And before I knew it, they were handing me, I think, Fig Newtons and apple juice, and they were like, get off the bus, we're done with you. And I couldn't believe how easy it was. And then there was the marrow side of it, and I never really understood, like, the marrow. I don't think that there's enough information out there, and I don't think that there are enough advocates, so hopefully you guys will get involved in this when I'm done with you. So it involved swabbing a cheek. And everyone thinks, oh, my God, there has to be some kind of invasive procedure or whatever else. But it was easy. They took a Q-tip, and you do kind of like you're brushing your, whatever. So you do your cheek, right, and they mail it away. And the first thing you're thinking, right, because your DNA is now on file, is that the NSA is going to get involved, right? And they're going to, like, do all kinds of studies on your DNA and send it to your health insurance and say, you know what, this person is going to have, they're going to have cataracts when they're 60, so don't insure them and all that other crap. But it turns out that Be The Match actually hides your DNA from the NSA. They have some, I don't know, maybe they hide it underground, I'm not sure. But, so, okay. So as long as you don't go on a mass murder spree, you're probably safe. So anyway, my story is, I did this thing with the blood center, and it was very difficult for me to get on that bus. But I did it every year, you know, because of something I had to do. But I didn't do it any other time, like most people go every 16 weeks, whatever, because I never understood where the blood goes. Did anybody really know? Like, I figured it went into like a big bucket somewhere. I don't know. You just don't know, right? And even as a police officer 20 years, I saw really horrific accidents and things like that. So you know that those people probably took blood products, but you're not really sure. I don't know. So it's kind of ironic the way fate has its way with you. So in November of 2010, at 40 years old, contracts were kind of changing, and I was fortunate enough that in my situation, I could retire after 20 years. So I left. And at the time, my ex wasn't my ex, and she's beautiful and talented, and I had three teenage kids that for some reason still thought I was kind of cool. So anyway, life was perfect for me. I got another job that was really challenging and financially rewarding, and it certainly wasn't for everybody, but for Mike Gama, it was kind of like, I was like, wow, man, this is the American dream. And that lasted 2 months, because in January of 2011, it was a Saturday, I'll never forget it, Saturday night. I'd had some blood work done because they thought I had Lyme disease. I had migraines. Anybody get those? They stink. I can't cuss with the, anyway. So they're horrible, right? So mine lasted 4 days. They thought I had Lyme disease. Everybody ever heard that, right? So they take the test and whatever. So I don't hear from them for like 10 days and migraines go away. And I get this call Saturday night. And it was my doctor. And she's like, I need you to sit down. I'm like, what? You know, Lyme disease, can't that wait till Monday? And she said, no. You have this blood cancer. It's pretty rare. It's called acute myeloid leukemia. I don't even know if I could still spell leukemia. So I certainly had no feel for what, in God's name, she was trying to tell me. But the gist of this conversation was that 70% of the cells in my blood system were cancerous. So I had no red blood cells working, no white blood cells. You guys have medical background? All right, so no immune system. I was anemic, and then no platelets, so if I was clumsy like normal and split my head, I probably would have bled out. So I didn't realize it, but on the phone, I'm kind of repeating everything she's saying out loud. And my kids, my oldest son was home from college, it was Christmas break, and then my other two kids are sitting on a couch, and we're all watching this movie called The Mask. It's Jim Carrey, and it's a Gama tradition. It's one of these things we get together and do. And my wife was standing there. So anyway, I'm kind of repeating this whole thing about cancer this, cancer that. And I was asking her, I'm a cop, so I want the facts. You know what I mean? I want it right now, and I can handle whatever. And she was like, you know, you're going to go into the hospital. I need you to go in 24 hours. You could pass away at home. And you're probably not coming out. So I'm thinking, I have things to do. I would tell my boss that, I'm going to be out sick for a couple days, and, you know, I need to pack a bag. And she was like, Mike, man, you're going to be there 6-7 weeks minimum, and that's if it works out. So forget your boss, forget everything. You just need to get there tomorrow. So the next day, I'm at Rhode Island Hospital. They started with a bone marrow biopsy. It's pretty horrific. I think it was invented by Hitler or something, I don't know, but it's brutal. And the person giving it to me at Rhode Island Hospital, I think I might have been her first. So it was like blood, I was like a horror movie. And I wasn't exactly the best patient, but whatever. So we get through it. And my first hospital stay was 51 days in one room. And they gave me enough chemo to basically kill a cow. It was bad. And the object of it is to destroy your entire blood system, and then kind of like, it's like kick-starting it so that it restarts, and hopefully you start to grow some decent cells. But with my type of leukemia, if you do achieve this remission, it lasts a couple of weeks, and then you're gonna go right back in and start the whole process over. It was about probably the fourth week in there where I had, I didn't have any blood left. And that's when I learned where the blood comes from, right? Because they waited until I was within a couple of hours. I mean, I was passing out. They were waiting until I was in a couple hours of suffocating until they gave me red blood cells, because they don't want to take any chances, right? And then I remember the platelet transfusion that I got. I got several of them. They waited until I could see little red dots on my skin from my blood. I was bleeding, right, internally. And I got dozens of these things. And during this process, it starts to occur to me. We live in New England, right? We have the best doctors and schools and hospitals anywhere in the world, right? And my doctor is a professor, Eric Weiner. He's a professor at Brown. He's brilliant. And he lives blood cancers in patients. Like, it's his thing. He never goes home and drives a beat-up car, even though he makes a ton of money. Like, I had everybody working for me, and I had this amazing nursing staff that was taking care of me 24 hours a day, even when I was miserable. And I had my family and my wife and my kids, and then, you know, I didn't feel like dying, right? So, like, I had all this pulling for me, and this medical science, and, like, state-of-the-art equipment working on me, and the medical protocols were like a week old. They had just been approved that they were using on me. Everything was like, you couldn't have asked for more things to be on my side. And yet, with all of that, what became painfully honest was that the only reason I was alive at that point, it was in February, was because of these unknown people. I don't even know who they are. I'll never know who they are, right? But they got on a bus, or they went to a blood center, and they went somewhere. They got on there, and they donated blood from Mike Gama, right? And after I actually achieved remission, day 51, I was pretty psyched. The blood center ran this Marrow drive for me in Narragansett. That's where I was a police officer. And like 300 people came, and they let me out of the hospital for like 5 days so I could go. And I had to wear a mask, all that crap. But it was pretty amazing. All these people showed up. It was awesome. But what they told me was that I was going to probably have to go through this process a couple of times, but that it would only work for about a year. So after that, what happens is that type of cancer that I had is so aggressive that you don't achieve remission anymore. And you die, right? So typically, a patient who doesn't get any chemo lasts about 16 weeks. If you get the chemo, you last about 11 months, 12 months. So my only chance of survival was through a stem cell transplant from a matching donor. And man, when you're on that side of it, it's pretty stressful. So in my case, there was a girl named Catherine Prince who was in college in North Carolina. And she was at a blood drive, and she saw the Be the Match desk, and she swabbed her cheek. That's all she did. She swabbed her cheek. And her DNA, now my name's Gama, Mike Gama from Rhode Island. And, you know, as far as generations anyway, from Rhode Island. And she's from North Carolina, Catherine Prince. Like, I have no idea how it matches, but it does. And our DNA match was perfect. And so they called her up, and she was like, yeah, it's no big deal. And she was in North Carolina, and they flew her to Washington, D.C. to do this bone marrow. It wasn't bone marrow, stem cell treatment, where they give you shots of Neupogen consecutive days and whatever. So she has this transplant, and this bag was like, I'm sure you guys have all seen the IV bag. So it looks like a transfusion. I get washed platelets, so it looks that big. It's only small, right? And it's like yellowish. So it made it from Washington, D.C. to Logan. I was up at Dana-Farber. In about 4 hours. And on June 3rd, 2011, everybody was like around me, and there was probably a dozen people watching, and I had 100 bags of stuff going into me. I had the Hickman lines and all that stuff. So this was, I'm like, I don't understand what's the big deal. But there was like everybody watching and seeing what happened to me and everything else. And so 40 minutes later, the bag's empty. And they're like, I'm like, so now what? They're like, wait. And those stem cells, hers, Catherine's, found their way into my, what used to be marrow, grew new marrow, and grew a whole new blood system for me. So my blood type went from B positive to A positive. I got smarter. I inherited Catherine's allergies because I have her immune system, which is kind of crazy, because I never had allergies, and now I have a sinus infection, but I'm grateful. And yeah, I didn't get women's intuition. I think I got ripped off. And I didn't get hair. That's a bunch of crap, too. But anyway, so I lived, right? So I'm out of the hospital 4 weeks, and I was coming back really quickly, and this other girl, Jen, that had got me to stick myself with the needle 4 years earlier, get a hold of me, and she asked me, she's like, how you feeling? I'm like, not too good. She said, would you come and give a speech or talk to some people? So I did, and it was a little tiny town hall. It was a little tiny Richmond in Rhode Island. And I started with the blood center. And so here's the thing, right? When you get people to swab their cheeks, you always tell them, look, you're the only thing, because you're not employees, you can say this. You're the only thing standing between that patient, if you match them, and absolute death. Because a stem cell transplant is the last option. It's that or it's dead, and there's nothing else. So they talk about, you know, she'll tell you, when you donate blood, right, you save 3 lives, because they break it up into parts. And if you are a match for somebody, for a stem cell transplant, you're saving that person. But that doesn't even touch it. And this is what I mean. All those people that donated blood, and Catherine Prince, they saved my life, right? And there's that one, I'm the one guy, I'm him. And I'm wicked grateful, right? But she's heard this 20,000 times. So this is how I liken it. And I know this analogy's been beat up, but it's like throwing a pebble into a pond, because I'm just the first, Mike Gamma's the first ripple. Because what those donors also did was they prevented my wife from becoming a widow at 34. They prevented my kids from losing their dad as teenagers, you know? And like, I have a couple friends who dig me, so they would have been wicked sad. So there, you know, so now the ripples get bigger. And then when I got involved with the Blood Center, such an awesome organization, I started to do these speeches, right? And I got to meet awesome people like yourselves, and I've gone to universities, and I've gone to high schools, and I've gone to businesses and banks, and I don't know, they've dragged me pretty much everywhere. And it's been awesome, and I've got to meet all these amazing people like yourselves. And then hopefully the people that I meet, now they become advocates for the blood and the marrow, right? So think about that girl, Catherine Prince, just swabbing her cheek. Think of how many lives she's touching. And, you know, and I'm volunteer, so they can't fire me, so I'll still do the speeches forever. So as long as I live, I'm gonna still reach more people, hopefully. So if you think about it, man, you could talk about thousands of people all from a cheek swab. Kind of blows your mind if you think about it, right? So a little off topic, but I'm going to hit it anyway because I love the Blood Center so much. In 2014, because of these speeches, and they're so grateful and such an awesome organization, they flew Catherine Prince up from North Carolina, and they threw this big, was it gala? I don't know, what do you call it?
Oh,
a thing, yeah. They threw this thing, and they put me on stage, and they brought her out, and they paid for this whole thing for me. And I got to meet my angel, right? I call her my angel. She's kind of, right? Wouldn't you call her that? Because she's the only thing between me and dead. So I cried for like a week. And it was pretty, and I owe it all to these guys because she got to spend the weekend with me. And, you know, we're Facebook buddies now and everything's awesome because of the Blood Center helping out. But, and granted, that's off topic. But what I need you guys to understand is the importance of a cheek swab. And when people ask, well, what do I have to do? You swab a cheek, and if you get called, you are the only thing between that person and death. And I'll give one more little thing, and then I'll go because I think we're running out of tape. But I have this convenience store. It's a mobile station, right? And I drive by it every time I'm heading north. And so I stop in there, and I'm friendly with the owner, and he's a super guy. He and his family run the whole place. And he had asked me where I'd been for like 2 years, because after a stem cell transplant, you're stuck in a house, can't go anywhere. And so I told him the story. And I was like, not for nothing, but you know, I was lucky because I'm from Western Europe, and there's a ton of Western Europeans on this match. So, but there's problems with other ethnicities. And if you're mixed race, man, your chances of finding a match are even less, because you think about DNA, right? It's where you're from. So he's from India. So I talked to him, and he was like, oh, wow, that sounds really good. So I convinced him to go on bethematch.com, and he swabbed his cheek. So this is so crazy. A month and a half ago, he calls me. He's a match for a four-year-old, right? So he's going to save this. And it was only because, and he was worried, like, what does it entail? I go, dude, you're going to save a four-year-old kid's life, and if you don't do it, that poor kid doesn't have a chance. So I'm taking him to New Jersey on May 24th for 2 days, and we're going to go through the whole process. Because it's a little kid, they don't do the stem cells. It's a little more successful when they do a marrow donation. So he's going to go through the marrow. I think it might actually be easier. I'm not sure. But so, yeah, so we're going to go down there, and we're going to save a four-year-old kid, and it's all because I talked to him. Right? So if you guys could do that, think of the lives you could save. You might save somebody you know. Could be your life. Like, I didn't know in 2010 that I was going to need a stem cell transplant. Man, I was, like, living life large. So if you guys could jump on that bandwagon, I would really appreciate it. And thank you all for not falling asleep on me. You guys are pretty awesome. I love you guys. Thank you. Any questions?
Yes.
Yeah.
And in good health. Then we get your DNA typing just from that swab, goes into a database that sits on there between the day you register and the day you turn 61. And if it ever looks like you're a match for someone, the next step is to have you do some blood work so we can see if you're the best match for that patient. And then if you are, we would ask you to be the donor. We have you do an info session with our donor coordinator. She goes over everything you can expect, make sure questions you have are answered, that you feel comfortable moving forward. And then we have you do a complete physical to make sure there's no medical risks at all for you to donate. But most of the time, it's an automated blood donation, the actual donation. It's a lot like doing platelets or double red cells. The difference is we give you a series of injections over 5 days. It's a drug that just makes your bone marrow produce extra cells and then kind of spit them out into your circulating bloodstream. The donations on the 5th day of those injections, you'll be on an apheresis machine for about 4 to 6 hours, depending on the number of cells that they need to collect. Taking the blood from one arm, running it through, scooping off those cells we need, returning everything else back to you through the other arm. It's kind of boring, you're kind of hanging out like this, but if you're here, you would do that actually right at the blood center in Providence, and I know our nurses would take really good care of you. They will bring you cookies, they will tell you you're a hero because you are. They'll make sure you have a blanket and you're nice and warm, and you know, we'll take good care of you. We do that about 75% of the time. The surgical procedure, like Mike said, is what we usually ask for if you're matching a child. They've just seen better outcomes for kids when they get cells that were donated that way. But it's still not as scary as Grey's Anatomy or House or any of those shows like to make it out to be. It's done under anesthesia, so you don't feel anything while it's happening. The doctor's going to the back of the pelvic bone, so kind of where the dimple is in your lower back, with a syringe to just suction out those same cells from your marrow. There isn't usually even an incision, so no stitches. Lots of times they'll keep you overnight in the hospital just for an observation to make sure nothing's going on with the anesthesia. And all of the donors that I know have said it feels like you slipped and fell afterwards. It's that kind of an achiness in your lower back. I mean, who among us hasn't? It's New England, like Mike said, who hasn't fallen on the ice and, you know. So it's that kind of an achiness. Typically back to a normal routine in a couple of days, little achy, little sore for a week or so. Either way that you donate, our staff follows up with you until you're back to 100%. So that's it. Yeah.
Are there any risk factors with the injections?
So the risk factors with the injections, if you look at our form, you will see there's a whole bunch of questions about bleeding disorders and blood clots, those types of things. That's where the risk comes in. So those injections,
They make your blood thicker because there's more cells in them. So we're really careful with anyone who's had any bleeding disorders, clotting disorders, head injuries. They just have a high, you have a higher risk of developing additional clots from taking that drug. The drug itself is always going to be under, I don't know the correct term for it. Is there like a review? It's not an IRB, I know it's not that. But it's always going to be studied because this process isn't what it was initially labeled for. It's Neupogen or filgrastim, and it's given to cancer patients to help bring their numbers up, their counts up. So Mike had it on the other side too.
The FDA,
yeah. So it's always going to be under study. That's part of the reason after someone donates, we call them through infinity just to follow up and make sure there's nothing going on. As of now, there has been no reported increased risk for any diseases based on donors who've had the filgrastim or Neupogen. And then with the surgical procedure, it's mainly that anesthesia risk that's the big one.
And how long has this process been, procedure been performed so that they like the study?
The study, it's been going on for at least 20 years.
So there haven't been any reported cases in 20 years?
Nope. Yeah,
just to give you a little more depth into the actual numbers, there are about 14,000 people on the list right now looking for a match. And about half of them each year will find a donor. And the other half does not.
So
that's why we look at increasing numbers.
What's the success rate for it?
It's about 60% right now. So it goes up. It's been going up. I've been doing this since 1998, and it was around 40% then. So as the science gets better for transplant in general, but also matching technology gets better, we've seen an increase. Granted, 60 is not great. It's better than what it was.
That number's kind of skewed because they'll take not a perfect match. So I was really lucky. At the time, they were looking at 10 advantages. I don't know.
Yep.
So they're looking at 10 different factors, and I had a 10 out of 10 match. But there are hospitals, there's one in New York City that will take like a 6 out of 10. So that, and when you're a 6 out of 10, basically what you're doing is you're putting someone else's immune system in you. So when, it's the opposite of when you have an organ donated, right? So when you have an organ donated, your immune system is attacking the organ. When you have your immune system donated, your immune system, this new immune system is attacking your whole body. So if you're not close enough, that kicks the crap out of you. So I still have some of those issues because we're not perfect, right? And she probably gets mad being stuck aside it. So, I mean, that happens. So that's why the numbers aren't necessarily as high as you might think.
So yeah, there's different levels of matching. And each transplant center has kind of a different number system.
Dana-Farber's tough.
Yeah, lots of them will look for 12 out of 12 match, or I think Dana-Farber looks for 12 out of 12 match.
Yeah,
some of them do a 10 out of 10 match. So sometimes you'll hear people say that, oh, I have a 9 out of a 10 match. You obviously want the closest one that you can get. That means you're going to have the least amount of issues afterwards. So graft versus host disease, which is what Mike's talking about, where they kind of fight. And it can be anything from some dry eye, some mouth sores, to really severe intestinal issues. It kind of runs the gamut. But really, the better the matches, the less of those that you get.
There are medications that the patients do go on to prevent graft versus host. But it's a different combination for every patient, every donor, recipient match, every cancer type. So it will help prevent the recipient's immune system from attacking. It recognizes, and those that aren't perfect matches, and sometimes even those that are perfect matches, it recognizes that it's not the same. It's foreign, and your immune system is programmed to fight something that isn't foreign, that is foreign.
I should get off. So eventually, if it works, that level of immunosuppressants basically is. Hopefully the levels go down, but every case is individual.
So, and there is some new, so you said the 6 out of 10 matches. So this is kind of a new thing that's coming back around, and they're called haplo-identical matches. So basically it's a half match. And most of the time when they're doing those, they're taking a half match from a sibling or even a parent, because they're thinking, well, it's a close enough match. They did this for a while back in the early 90s. They didn't see really good results for it, but the technology has now kind of leaps and bounds. So they've been testing this again in clinical trials, and they've seen some really good results so far. So it's still early, in that, but I know two patients who have had haploidentical transplants, one from his half-brother and one from his mom, and they're both doing fabulous. So that's awesome, because that opens up a whole new world of possibility for people who can't find an unrelated match. We're always going to look for a sibling match first, because they're your most likely genetic match, but only about 25% of people find or have a match within their family. So the other 75% are on the registry for a stranger who's willing to take that little bit of time, donate their cells, and help save someone they may never know. So in the States, if you, after a year of anonymous contacts, if you both release your contact information, then you can have direct contact. It varies from country to country. So that's the cool thing too. You could get on the registry, you'd be based here in Rhode Island, but wherever you, or in Massachusetts, but just over the bridge. You'd be based right here, you donate most of the time locally. Occasionally there's instances where...
His issue is Marrow, because they do that at Mass General, and sometimes Mass General, because
they
don't do enough
booked.
Of that, Mass General doesn't necessarily, they don't go out of their way, because, you know, I mean, their rooms are important, so
yeah.
In this case, we have to go to New Jersey.
Yeah.
But it's no big deal, we're saving a four-year-old.
And we try, we try and get it to the closest center that you're closest to now, but then some courier will get on a plane when you're done with that with your bag, like Mike said, your bag of blood in a little six-pack cooler. Get on a plane, take it to wherever in the world it needs to go, and then usually within 24 to 48 hours, it's transfused in that person, and they're sitting there waiting and hoping those cells, you know, kind of do their thing and go where they need to go and start making new happy cells.
And I believe Jennifer just got to do that, and she got to go where?
I can't say exactly where I went because of confidentiality reasons, but I have been a courier a couple of times. So someone donated here at our center in Providence. I took the cooler, got on a plane, I went to Europe. And then those cells, you don't realize until that cooler's in your hands how big of a responsibility that is. You literally have someone's life in the cooler in your hands. That cooler does not leave your eyesight, so it's like, you know, no dose and 5-hour energies, like, constantly. You know, you're sitting on the plane with it under the seat in front of you because it can't go in the overhead because you don't want it to tip over or anything like that. You need to be able to see it at all times. So if you get up to use the restroom on the plane, the cooler goes with you, and you have to let the flight attendants know that this is what you have. You don't have a bomb. It's human cells that need to get to a certain place in a very timely manner. But it's this huge relief when you hand it off to the lab staff at the other hospital. But it's also, it really kind of hits you that you're that link in the chain, too. You know, I come out, and my job is to come out in community engagement. Come out and talk to groups and work with professors and students and businesses to get this word out there about what marrow transplant is and kind of take away those myths that are perpetuated. But I'm lucky enough to work in a donor center, too, where there across the hall from me sit the ladies who call the people who are matches. So, you know, they lots of times will know if I've done a drive, and they'll come in and be like, oh, my God, football player from Salve just matched, and he's going to do it, and he's matching this person. So, like, I know that, and then, you know, I know who that person is. It's really cool when that happens, when I get to see that. So then to see even more so actually where those cells are going is really, really cool. But Mike's ripple analogy is like my favorite thing, because it really is. Even just talking to you guys today, if you can't join the registry or you don't feel like it's something that you could do, at least now you have that information. So when someone says, you say bone marrow, and somebody goes, oh my God, that's horrible. They drill into your spine with a needle that's like this big. It's awful. It's terrible. You can say, no, I went to this thing and I heard about it, and this is what it really is. So it's more and more people, more and more ripples knowing the truth about it, and knowing how important it is and what it can do, how it can change people's lives. And it really is just, are you laughing?
No, I'm smiling. I'm like,
smiling, okay.
She's laughing, I'm gonna give you a hug.
So it really, really is, and it's just, it's amazing when, you know, and I got called, I've been on the registry since 1998, so I joined in college myself. I lived in Vermont, my mom worked at a hospital, she wanted to do a marrow donor drive at her hospital because there had never been a donor drive in Vermont at that point, which is mind-blowing. So her hospital sponsored it. I was in college, so she said, guess what? You need a project. You can do the PR for our marrow donor drive. So, you know, my mom kind of got me into this, and I got on the registry. Back then, I had to have blood drawn to get onto the registry. So I've been sitting on the registry. I was a Marrow volunteer in Vermont for 10 years. When I moved down here, I started working at the blood center. This is what I do. So my mom likes to gloat and tell everybody that she found my career for me, which is fine, because then she also tells people that I'm now her boss, because she's a volunteer ambassador for me in Vermont and holds Marrow drives up there. But one day, I was running out of the blood center to actually go talk to a group of students at University of New Haven. And as I'm running across the lobby, my phone beeps with an email, and I'm one of those neurotic people who checks it every time it beeps. So I look at it, and it's an email from Be the Match. I'm like, well, now what do they want? I got to go do something. What do they want me to do right now? But then I opened it, and I looked at it, and I was a potential match. I was at the very first step. I was a preliminary match. So they basically just wanted to know if I was still interested, if I was still healthy, and if they could find me. But it made me, like, stop in my tracks. Like, in all of the craziness that was going on in that week and that day and the things that I had to do, and I do this every day, to get that email made me just, like, stop and be like, oh, my God, I think I said that in the lobby. I think I scared the receptionist. She's like, is everything okay? Fine. It might be a match. But then, you know, my mom was the first person I called, and then that group of students down in New Haven were the other first people I told, and it was awesome because they were as excited as I was. Now, I wasn't the best match for the patient, which is fine. I called them right away and said, I'm here if you need me. So they didn't need me, which means there was a better match for that patient, which is awesome too. So lots of people will tell me, I've never gotten called, they've been on for years. The way to look at that is there's just no one sick who needs you, but you're there if they do, and that's awesome. So that's kind of my wrap up. Does anybody have any more questions?
I had a question for Mike. Oh yeah, sure. Your sinus infection, they consider that was a rejection of Catherine's?
Nope, allergies.
Was it a big deal because you had no immune system?
Oh, no, so I have one now. No, my immune system is actually, I'm off immunosuppressants. It's been, June 3rd will be 5 years.
Because it's serious if you get, well, you don't have an immune system.
Yeah, no, infection. I spent two years, man, in like a room. So I get it, yeah. I probably did a lot of stuff I shouldn't have done.
So you never had any rejection?
I don't know, what are you going to do? So this one I'm just, and besides, I kind of like having this one, because it gives me something to complain about. Like, it's the worst case of sniffles you guys have ever seen.
Well, just to explain that a little more, when you get the stem cell transplant, it replaces the red cells, the white cells, the
yeah,
cells,
everything.
And anything. So his cells, his immune system cells, the ones that cause the allergies for those of us that suffer from that, are also in that mix.
So if I pull OJ, she goes to jail. No, seriously. Yeah.
And I don't know if you had any of this, but I knew a guy who had a transplant. His donor was from Italy. So before his transplant, he told me he hated seafood. Hated it. Couldn't stand it. Had his transplant. The guy was from Italy, like, only speaks Italian. They have to communicate through the guy's kids who can translate for them. But now he loves seafood. He loves, like, shrimp is like his new favorite thing. And one time they were talking, he's like, hey, you know, do you like shrimp? He's like, yeah, I love it. He's like, me too. So it's just weird. Yeah. Did you get any, like, weird things that you didn't used to like?
Women's underwear?
Do you like?
No. I'm just kidding, I swear.
Do you like boy bands now? So yeah, it's just weird. Like, that's the sci-fi part of it I love to tell people too. It's like, you said, the blood type changes,
yeah.
Which
yeah,
is weird.
Awesome.
So, yeah.
So I have two questions.
Yeah.
Two questions. How do you decide who gets the, like, in my situation, like, how did he got on a registry also?
Nope. So they take your blood work and then they...
It's not like other organ donation, like other organ transplant things where there's a list and people are in order, I guess. It's not like that because it's such a DNA level match. It's like nearly impossible to have someone matching two people at the same time. So it's just, you know, basically it's a computer database. So his doctor searched his typing against all those people in the registry. Probably you may have, did you have a few potential matches?
I'm Italian Irish, so like I started out with like 40 that were like, you know, when they start the bottom of the barrel.
Possible.
Yeah,
so the widest.
It was like, I think I had four or five that were perfect matches. But you gotta think, someone may have passed away, someone may have developed an illness, or someone may have moved and they can't get a hold of them anymore. You know, there's all kinds of different factors. That's why we all need to be advocates for this.
Yeah,
so everyone gets on there. Yeah.
So in that case, though, if Mike didn't have insurance, and I know it costs, somebody has to pay like $100,000 to $200,000 for this
transplant
place.
It's very
expensive. So how does it happen? Like, who pays for it? Like, if Mike didn't have insurance, would he even be searched? Like, would he even
There are grants, I know, so the National Marrow Donor Program, which is the parent nonprofit that Be The Match is the registry part under, they do have funding for patients who need financial assistance.
I think Blue Cross has a hit out on them now. They're about bankrupt.
So the patient's not going to be like, you know, with a 60% chance, and in Mike's case it was 100%, like he had his life, you know, given to him, mm-hmm. or shared with him from Angel.
Yep.
And, So, I mean, is he going to be, like, now, like, financially logged down, like, forever? Like, who pays for it? I know the insurance pays for part of it, but...
Yeah, and if you're, if, you know...
Depends on the hospital.
Yeah, it depends on the hospital, it depends on the insurance. You know, I know that is one of the barriers to transplant. That National Marrow Donor Program works on an ongoing basis, is, you know, getting people to the doctor so that they're diagnosed earlier, which means their treatment is you know,
much more successful,
and they have a better chance. But yeah, there are still some disparities there. We do have programs to help pay for searches and that kind of stuff. We have patient services office.
So you're a nonprofit?
We're a nonprofit. Yep.
That's where a lot of the community health centers around will promote. They promote, like, for in Massachusetts, Union Mass Health, and working with students to lower costs, because it is really important to not skip those yearly physicals and to really get checked out. Because, you know, I've worked in labs where I'm a lab tech, so we have gotten a patient coming into the emergency room. You can look on their history; they haven't been there for years, and I'm the one that puts it under the scope, looks in it, and goes, and you lose your breath because the entire field is 100% the youngest cancer cell, which means it's been there a very long time, and it's covering. You know, and that's something, you know, someone had posted on Facebook, because it's National Medical Laboratory Week, so we're celebrating, you know, everyone who does that, and someone had posted, you know, I am fascinated, I love my job, I love the cells, but to me, when I look at that, that's a patient behind it, and I am the one that is seeing for the first time the news that they're going to get. You know, so that's something, you know, that we do see, and a lot of the community health centers are really trying to target providing care early on.
You've had a question in the back.
Yeah. Well, you guys, while the experts are all here, you just sent me into a panic because I swabbed my cheek like 4 years ago, but I've gotten divorced and remarried and had many. So I don't have any of the right contact information.
Go be the match.org.
Be the match.
I'm on there. It says I have to enter in the donor center, my donor.
If you don't have that, the best thing to do is to just give the 800 number a call. They can look you up by your birthday, update everything.
I was like, oh my God, it's useless.
So don't ignore those. If you do decide to get on the registry, don't ignore the emails you get every year. I get them. I get my husband's emails as well, and I click, yep, he's committed.
Yeah. So that's a big thing too. Is right now, actually, you know, this sucks. Is there's there is a problem with people on the registry not being available when we contact them. So a lot of that, you know, sometimes we'll hear well-meaning groups go out and tell students, you know, if we're on a campus, just come in and do this. Just do the paperwork. Just do the cheek swab. You can say no later. That makes, like, I do like this when I hear that, because that's the wrong message that we want. We don't want people saying that. We want people to come in and talk to us, absolutely. We want to give them the facts that we've given you today, but we only want them to get onto that registry if they know with like a 99% chance, given, you know, there's not some crazy thing that happens, when we call them, they're going to say yes. Because as Mike can attest to, when you're sitting in that hospital bed and your life is in the hands of that person answering the phone and saying, yeah, I signed up to do that. I know what it is. I'm going to do it. Man, you hope that they're going to say that. And it's awful. I mean, like I said, I work across the hall from the ladies who make those phone calls. And the whole office just goes into, like, this suck pit when somebody says no. It's like you're just like, where did they sign up? Who signed them up? Who, you know, you're trying to figure out why this person may have said no. And it makes you really sad for that patient who's out there, because when we're calling you, we only know that you're a potential match. We don't know if there are other donors somewhere else in the world that the doctors are also looking at. So all we know, in our minds, you're the only match for that patient. And it's our job to find you, you know, make sure you're educated, make sure you're ready to go through with this. So it's really important. Like I said, it's a big step to get onto the registry. It is just the paperwork and cheek swab to get on, but there is a commitment there. No, it's not legally binding. We're not going to take you to court. We're not going to force you to do this. But if you get onto the registry, we really, really want you to be sure that you would go through and donate. And it's okay if you need to stop and think about it for a little while, or you're not in a place in your life where it would be something that you could do. That's fine too. You have until you're 44 to get onto the registry. We're all over the place. We'll find you when you're ready.
You know what I think is probably important too, and I'm sure, I know you did this when you were here, but I've actually been told by like friends and family of mine, the long time when she posted the picture of us at the drive, people were like, what if your kids need your bone marrow someday? Like, what if a family member needs them? People don't understand that bone marrow regenerates.
It replenishes.
They need the kidney, and they're like, you give it to someone you don't know.
Yeah.
Like, I've actually had hostile reactions to it, and it's, I think a lot of just public awareness about what bone marrow is.
Absolutely.
TV shows don't help.
Yes. Right. I thought we said if I ever meet Hugh Laurie, he and I are going to have some fun. And I was in London last summer, and I kept hoping he'd come onto the tube while I was on there so we could have a chat.
That's where you come into play as well.
Yeah, so now you can say, no, that's not what it is. We never take so many cells that you would be left immunocompromised at all. And the cells we do take replenishes within 4 to 6 weeks.
And the cells they do take would function for you at that time anyway. Stem cells don't have a function. They're told what to do later.
You could also get stem cells from placenta.
Those are different kind of stem cells.
Cord bloods.
Yeah, cord bloods. Oh, cord bloods. Yeah, yeah. We do maintain a cord blood registry, so moms who, when they deliver and they donate their cord blood.
You
don't have as many cells.
There's not as many cells in the cord units themselves because it's small. So if those are typically best used for a child because of the small number of cells. If they're being used for an adult, they usually have to do a double cord blood transplant, so then you got to find two cords that are a close match.
Same thing with controversial fetuses.
That one's different.
That's totally different.
Yeah, that's what I tell people. It's not the controversial stem cells. But cord blood transplants, often we see them going for patients who are genetically diverse. So, as Mike said, matching comes down to your ancestry. So there are certain markers within your HLA typing that are more common within different races and ethnicities. So that's why we need to diversify the registry. But even as we diversify the registry every year, there are still people who have mixed heritage that's just, you would never, there's so few people.
My kids are Thai. My kid's mother's Thai. So,
yeah. So I don't know, there was a big campaign just a couple of months ago, Match for Lara. Lara was a young woman in the UK who was born in the UK, grew up there. She was Thai Italian. So not a lot of people who are Thai Italian in the world, much less who are on the National Marrow Donor Registry. So we work with a little girl from Cumberland, Rhode Island, who we've worked with since she's 2. She's 7 now. And she is Chinese Iranian. So think about how many people have that combination in their life and how many of them are on the registry. Coolest thing happened to me though, I was at Dartmouth College and I was talking to this girl. We were doing a drive for Match for Lara. It was an international exchange student. She knew Lara. She went to university with her in the UK. And we were talking and I was telling her the same thing about little Izzy with the Chinese Iranian heritage. And she like stopped and she looked at me and she went, I'm like Chinese Filipino Iranian. I could be her match. So it was like that one of those moments where you get like the goosebumps, and she was headed back to Scotland the next Monday. So when she got home to the UK, she was going to join the registry over there immediately. So it was just, that was cool.
Just a perfect example. I mean, think about your family's coming here. You know, they've always called the United States a melting pot. Well, my poor kids, I'm a quarter of a bunch of different things. And my husband, we think, is maybe half and half. He's adopted, so we're not sure about his genetics. So, but I mean, my kids could potentially have, you know, these little sections. you know, Irish, German, Lithuanian, Scottish, Canadian Indian. You know, I mean, you just keep listing all these little tiny portions and think about putting the genetics into that mosaic. And I'm going, oh my gosh, what did I do to my childhood?
Well, one of the director of our HLA lab at the blood center in Providence gave this example to a student that I was sitting in on with one day. He said, imagine you're in a room of 200 people, and you're looking for somebody who also is wearing a pair of Nikes. Okay, you can probably find somebody who's wearing a pair of Nikes, right? But now you're looking for someone who is wearing the exact same color Nikes in the exact same size, and oh, by the way, is wearing the exact same color socks that you're wearing. It's literally like that. It's so difficult to find a match. So that's why the more and more people we put on the registry, the more and more people we're bringing into that room with the opportunity to find someone who has all of those things.
For the recipient,
all of the medical costs for the recipient So all of the medical costs for the donor are part of the transplant costs for the patient. So there's no cost for the medical stuff. It's on the donor's end. And then anything else like the transportation, so like Mike driving to New Jersey, we will cover his mileage for that.
She flew somewhere to get her transplant,
My daughter, had to go from North Carolina to D.C. We pay for it. The room, food, whatever. Yeah.
Even here, so even if you were donating through the surgical procedure up in Boston, we'd likely have you stay in a hotel the night before, like one of the hotels right across the street, because we would want you there so early for prep, like 7 o'clock, and you know trying to get into Boston at 7 o'clock in the morning ain't happening.
Yeah.
So we usually put the donor up in a hotel right nearby the night before. Yeah.
So you guys do like the paperwork too? So say she has a job or say she is in school and she can't take the time off. Is there some kind of paperwork situation that makes them all set to stop?
We can help with that. Yep. We can talk to employers, coaches. We do a lot of stuff with athletic teams. Employers, pretty much anybody you can think of. We're there to explain to them what is going on. Why it's important. There's Facebook, and even in cases we can reimburse them for wages that they may miss while they're donating as well. So we're trying to reduce any barrier that could be there for them. I mean, we will pay for not only child care but pet care, which would be awesome for me because I got three dogs and they're a handful. But we would also pay for daycare
so
if you needed
them.
You
can go online and sign up and they send you a kit.
You can sign up today.
We have some paperwork and cheek swabs here if anybody wanted to do it. We also have some informational stuff too. So
I'm awaiting a stem cell transplant next month. I had Hodgkin's. Dana Farber called me last week and said there was a match and they would get back to me. They haven't heard yet.
So
I don't know if they just had the swab, and they were one of the so many people who were tested, if they've gone in to have the blood drawn, I'm not sure.
Yeah, they might be waiting to hear the results of the blood work to see if they're the best match, or they might be waiting, they might have already had that and know that that's a good match, but they're waiting to figure out those logistic things of timing.
I already had one stem cell transplant in 2013.
Wow.
2011, I had Hodgkin's, had ABVD chemo, radiation. 2 years later, it came back, Hodgkin's came back, and had the stem cell transplant at Brigham and Women's.
Your own stem cells?
My own stem cells.
Yeah.
I was in the hospital for 3 weeks, 3 months.
6'4"?
Yeah. 6'8".
Yep.
Was out of commission for 3 months, and now it'll be a little bit longer. They said it's 8 days in the hospital, but 6 months of not being able to.
Yeah.
And I'm having my third chemo tomorrow.
She's all Polish.
I'm all Polish. So my doctor said there's a very good chance in Europe.
Yep, the German registry is very robust. So they do a good job over there. So we'll be thinking of you.
Thank you.
We're glad to hear you.
Katie's cheering in the back.
Yeah,
I'm Polish.
You're Polish?
Yeah, Polish.
You mixed with anything?
No.
Straight up Polish.
I'm a purebred.
We'll be thinking of you.
Did you find out if you guys are related? You and Catherine? I'm just curious.
No. No.
No answer.
Which obviously, you have to be. You have to be, right?
Somewhere down the line, yeah. I assume so, yeah.
So I have actually, I don't know, do you know Maxine Renning? Did you ever meet Maxine? She's one of our...
I have chemo brain, or at least I tell people that.
I have chemo brain.
I didn't remember coming here last year.
So Maxine was one of our donors who registered while she was in college, and when we called her, she said yes. She matched a young woman who at the time was 26 and needed a transplant. Maxine was 19 or 20, so they were very similar in age. She donated. Jenna did really well. Her recipient, Jenna, did really well for a while. They got to meet. They actually met at the National Marrow Donor Program's annual council meeting. So all of the people from the transplant world from all over the world, about 1,500 people in a room, and they got to meet for the first time there. They looked similar. They, you know, both had red hair. And they both had very similar kind of features. Like, you would think, oh, they could be sisters or cousins, like, if you just saw them. Their moms did Ancestry.com and found out that they have ancestors both from the same small town in Germany.
Wow.
From Ulm, Germany. So, yeah, so just kind of weird. The world gets smaller and smaller with all these cool things. But, yeah, it's interesting sometimes when you see patients and their donors meet and you say, yeah, they look similar. There's a girl out in,
so.
No, you, Catherine?
Plus, she's a librarian. I'm a cop. You know, the cop's standing at the window of the car. You know why I'm standing here? Yeah, you got C's in college. So, yeah, she's a librarian. So, yeah. Electrical engineering student. Ended up writing tickets for a living. Yeah, so I don't know. I don't have anything in common with that.
Then
so.
You know.
Yeah, I guess.
Nationality is Catherine.
She's Irish.
Okay.
She's Irish, but she.
Just curious if she's something completely different.
Yeah, and you know, she, and like, I'm wicked shy. She's actually shy. Like,
so,
yeah.
You're so, wicked shy.
Yeah.
In Bizarro.
Yeah, so yeah, she's difficult to. You have to, you know what I mean? Pull stuff out of her. But, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
So it has to be.
And sometimes you don't know. Like, there was a Good Morning America had a patient and their donor come and meet on Good Morning America back when Robin Roberts was going through all of her treatments. And, you know, we talk so much about how your ancestry is really important with this. So they have this woman come out. She is she's African American, and she's sitting there and she's talking with her family, and then they bring out her donor. He's a student from Yale, and he could not have been more Irish. His name was like Patrick O something, and he was like super white, blue eyes. Turns out the woman is Cape Verdean, and he, you know, it's somewhere in that past genetic, they just had the same commonality. And here, lots of times, people who are Portuguese or Cape Verdean, you know, you have like crazy weird things in there too, just because of the ports. You know, we worked with a man who identified as being Portuguese, did a lot of work in the Portuguese community, had a tough time finding a donor. And so his geneticist said, you've got like markers on here for Jewish and Swedish. And he's like, yeah, I was born in the Azores, so I'm guessing that's where that came from. Some, you know, people passing through. So it's really interesting. The stuff you don't know just way back in your ancestry that might show up. Surprise.
New Year's Eve, something like that.
So, yeah, any other questions?
Like, officially the best group I've ever talked to. I've been here an hour, right? Yeah,
thank
you guys are
so
awesome.
Much.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. And great questions. And if you have anything else, I'm going to stick around for a few minutes.
We'll stick around.
Thank you.